Welcome to the H Cloud. I'm not sure if we're. Good morning, everyone. This is the second day of the Horizon Cloud Summit 2021, and we're coming on top of an excellent day yesterday, where we had great presentations from a wide range of people, including Pierre Chastanet from the European Commission. Today, we're going to hear from Klaus Otradovets from Atos, and he's going to give us a short discussion of some key issues in cloud computing. But first, let me go through some housekeeping rules for our discussion today. All sessions are going to be recorded and they will be published on the event platform. You can use the SwapCard platform to post questions, and there will be a live Q&A at the end. And we strongly encourage you to join our discussion online in the HCloud portal. And use social media with the hashtags Horizon Cloud Summit and tag the HCloud project. If you have any technical issues, please ask your question in the chat. And today, again, we're going to be hearing from Klaus Otradovets, who is the VP of Global Service Delivery from Atos. He's also chair of the Architecture Working Group of Gaia-X. So, Klaus, over to you.
Thank you, Mark. So thank you for the introduction. And I was expecting to see my slides, but I can start talking a little bit about myself to begin with. I am part of what we call the Atos scientific community, a group of people in Atos who are looking forward, who are looking at what is going to happen in the next 4 years. And of course, cloud. What is happening with cloud is a significant topic there. And I don't give too much away, but one of the things I already like to highlight is that what we do see is it's not so much a technical kind of thing anymore. It's about how do you apply cloud technologies to build ecosystems? How do you build clouds to actually also resolve some of the bigger connected problems, like, for instance, decarbonization, climate change, overall aspects on how we actually address things like healthcare and so on and so forth. So one thing with our four-year outlook, with our radar, is clearly cloud is actually moving into quite a lot of also non-technical dimensions. I'm also what we call distinguished experts, so it's my job to also carry that forward thinking into the real applications, into the real situations that we're dealing with our customers. And this is all going to be around, well, I mentioned healthcare already, mobility, finance, Green Deal. I will perhaps even miss some of them. And in that function, as Mark mentioned, I'm working with Gaia-X, I'm working with IDSA, I'm working with the programs to actually build autonomous cloud capabilities in Europe. And today's presentation, I want to give you an idea on what our thinking behind all of these engagements is. And I said there's a lot of examples, but I'll start with one, which is actually perhaps something that we all are very, very impacted with by one way or another. We are not meeting physically because something is keeping us from meeting all together in person. And I want to use this as a basis, as an idea to think about how can the cloud on the horizon, how can a future setup of clouds actually help us to overcome our current situation and improve, for instance, virus remedies and threat mitigations. I'm using this as an example, and what you see in this slide is actually one facet of the situation. It is something I took out of a Gaia-X presentation given by Jérôme Tars from Philips, which shows how he sees the healthcare space connected in order to provide faster response to threats, but also better input into research, what is really going on, how can we specific vaccines or pharma, how can we manage the link between what is happening in the real world with with primary care or hospitals, with the situation in real life, and how can we relate that not only in one geography but in many geographies. And the link I want you to make is that if we have such a combination of different players in the healthcare space, we actually have a very, very diverse situation in where applications are operated, where data is held. For the intents and purposes of this discussion, I consider a hospital as an edge because it's a very isolated compute where you store data, where you run certain applications. We have, because we have a very, very regulated market, a lot of providers that still work in isolated, in private clouds, whereas in other areas where you see pharma companies having to support and willing to support a multi-hybrid cloud approach, some commercial services, so what we're doing, for instance, with our health devices, of course, use public clouds. Research is going to have to access capabilities of high performance computers, and are moving towards simulation with quantum technologies. So the key message in this slide, in order to address a healthcare data space, in order to address the full capabilities that we need to fight something like a disease, we have to provide a continuum between all these different deployment models, private, multi clouds, connecting to HPCs, connecting to quantum and research capabilities, and very, very, very much also need to connect to edge devices. It's a very specific definition of edge here, but you can, in other spaces, you can also carry that forward to isolated networks on a shop floor or isolated networks with compute that is very, very close to machines or to energy producers or to charging stations. The key thing is cloud in the future is going to be, has to support a continuum all the way from the edge to the public cloud, to the hyperscalers. And it will also have to support connectivity to other systems and to other data spaces. I make a connection here to another slide that has been presented at GAIA-X that was talking about mobility, because if we talk about vaccination, in order to allow seamless travel from one location to another, you also need something like a mobility data space and the healthcare data space. We all know the difficulties we have on our mobiles. It's still a tedious and complicated process to get it done, specifically if you're traveling internationally. But the promise of a connection of data spaces, the promise of a connection of all these different systems which are kept in different infrastructures will at the end be managed if we, on the one hand side, address the continuum, the technical capability to link edges to private clouds, to multi-hybrid and hyperscaler clouds. But it also does require that we extend our model on what we need in order to use these multi-cloud provider cloud continuum services, that we need to implement an idea through these future clouds where we have shared the capability to share identities and trust, where we have the capability to find and locate services and data which is spread all over the various systems, where we have a way to control the usage of data, and where we know that if we are moving, if we're jumping from one element of this distributed cloud to another element that we still remain within our compliant framework that we need to have to that we need to adhere to. I gave an example about what is happening in healthcare, what is happening in mobility. We of course are all terribly conscious of the regulatory, the privacy implications of such setup, and future multi-provider cloud edge continuums have to ensure that across the different systems we will be able to have an answer to the four questions that I'm posing here. So the key message is, The key message is it's not only about technology. In the technology aspect, we need to address interoperability of platforms. That's a question of architecture. That's a question of APIs. That's a question of the way we actually also provide connectivity. One thing I haven't explicitly mentioned, but it's easy to see in the mobility data space that we will have to, or many use cases will require a completely convergent capability of connection, whether you are mobile, whether you're traveling somewhere, whether you're in your car, think about autonomous driving, or whether you're in a fixed environment with a traditional interconnect, where you sometimes have very, very high requirements to latency and resilience. So next to all the software stacks, we'll have to find a way to make connectivity in multi-modes very predictable and interchangeable between the different technologies. And we have to find ways to provide scalability in a way that it's not only a single provider, perhaps providing the need, the capabilities to extend compute or storage, but that providers can share these capabilities across the board. Very, very similar to what we're doing. For instance, if you think about power generation, energy networks, this idea of sharing capabilities, sharing resources across the provider is, in our opinion, something we'll have to address in the future for interoperability. But also, if you think about it, for reducing the overall or increasing the overall efficiency and reducing the carbon footprint of compute going forward. Next to technology, what is going to be important is that we make sure that data protection, security, other regulatory requirements can be maintained across ecosystems of cloud providers and actually cloud users. If you think about this idea, we're connecting data, we're connecting services over cloud edge continuum, over multiple providers. We have to find a way to address data protection, security, other regulatory requirements. And we also have to provide ways to make it easy to actually come to a commercial relationship which allows for portability and reversibility, something quite a few code of conducts are addressing. And last but not least, there's a lot of discussion, and we had in our panel yesterday quite a few big exchange about autonomy or sovereignty, how it's called in many EU discussions. We also have to find a way where we balance the capabilities to provide services autonomously and the services that we will use and interconnect with from other parties which are not provided autonomous, for instance, by a given nation, by the EU, or by a specific region. And I say that in the beginning, I'll come back to this. For me, it's not a black and white situation. It's a way, it's a question of choice. But we need to provide a capability that we can link all these four dimensions, technology, regulation, commercial, and sovereignty in a wider idea of a multi-provider cloud edge continuum. Now, how do we gonna go about it? I mentioned we are Very, very active in a number of organizations. And this is actually just a snapshot of four that we are primarily involved with. It doesn't discount any of the others. It's just an illustration where we are currently focusing on providing the necessary reference architectures, the necessary policies and rules that we believe make such a multi-provider cloud edge situation working. So obviously, I started with introducing me as Gaia-X architecture lead. We're looking at Gaia-X to provide the foundation for digital ecosystems. When I mentioned we need to find trust, we need to ensure that all these different components of a distributed system have a very, very clear role. They can be validated against regulatory requirements. They can be validated against commercial and technical feasibilities. This is what Gaia-X is going to provide. It's providing the foundation to provide transparent, secure digital ecosystems. From a cloud perspective, I think it's very, very important in a way that we will not have the opportunity as individual stakeholders, as individual participants of an ecosystem to negotiate everything with all potential partners that are cooperating, because it's just an exponential problem. The more providers you have, the more participants you have, the more complex such a construct is. Gaia-X will provide a foundation where you agree, where we set some policies, where we set some rule once to provide a solid foundation to make fair, equal, distributed and federated ecosystems, both for infrastructure and data happening. Another aspect, if you have this basic foundation, you have a very, very concrete challenge to make sure if you give out data, what is actually going to happen with the data? What is the agreement? How data can be used? This is where we see the role of International Data Spaces Association. It's not the only way how you can exchange data, but if you want to maintain in control on how data, on your data is going to be used, the reference architecture, the connectors, the dApps and everything IDSA is providing is going to be the right foundation to do that. And then we have BDVA, we are also very active in, which is actually looking at how can we deal with all the information, how can we deal with the data through models, through, how we use data, how we can apply artificial intelligence, but also how we can do it in ethical ways. And ultimately, at the end, we need to find ways to effectively develop solutions, how we can use the data, how we can use all these components to create services. And this is where we are looking at Freeware, providing the framework for open source components for various industries. Again, not everybody to try to identify their own models, their own APIs, but having a multi-provider open source way to define APIs that can easily be reused so we can accelerate the work going forward. So I try to summarize it in one quick sentence. We believe that it is important to have a multi-party governance, have all of or many of us work together on defining the policies, the rules, the architectures, the APIs that make such a multi-provider cloud edge continuum happening. And what you see in all of these groups is there's not going to be a big one or a small one. Generally, members, participants have actually one company, one vote. So it is one thing we believe is going to make this new cloud edge continuums working, having a joint definition of what the rules are, and drive it through these open associations. So this part has taken a lot of input into what kind of regulation, commercial sovereignty solutions we can find. There's one thing that I've also mentioned at the beginning, we're working at is the technology view. And this is a very specific technology view because it is derived from the use cases like health, like manufacturing, like autonomous driving, like energy finance, where companies in the European Union have looked at where are our autonomous capabilities, where are our capabilities to work together in order to create such a solution that will work across German, Italian, French, Spanish, Slovenian, whatever kind of providers. How are we going to build a solution that is going to work about across mobile edges and edges that are, for instance, on a company's shop floor? And one of the things we are very engaged in is also a joint endeavor of about 60 companies, if I remember correctly, 12 nations in Europe, where we are working on a set of software that allow us this level of interoperability on the hardware and deployment mode side, all the way from the device to on-premise solutions to far near edges and regional edges and the cloud solutions. So all type of different classes of devices, ensuring across the stack the requirements to have secure operations, so cybersecurity across the whole stack, energy efficiency across the whole stack, a certain level of standardization in order to make sure everything is interoperable, all the way bottom up from the infrastructure that's being built, to the interconnection that is providing the necessary glue between the parties, but also to services that allow different operators to distribute workloads, to do common monitoring across different type of deployments, all the way to the platforms that are needed to ultimately run applications like analytics, like the artificial intelligence I was talking about before. It's again very, very important. It's again an initiative where many multi-providers are working together to find one solution that is resolving this issue of multi-cloud provider, cloud, edge, continuum, to address the use cases that I've been hinting at the beginning. One thing that I also mentioned was sovereignty, the capability to actually provide everything autonomously and also be absolutely sure that nobody can actually force us to, for instance, divulge data that should belong to us. So I just mentioned, I don't want to go too much into it, but just mention, for instance, the Cloud Act. There are areas where we actually have to be extremely sensitive and ensured that we have complete sovereign control over our technical capabilities and the way we're operating, the way we're managing data. What I want to express with this slide is it's actually presenting an offering we've built or an explanation we've built. Sovereignty is also happening on a little bit of a continuum because I always like to say a supply chain never stops in Europe. A virus does never stop in Europe. We have to find solutions to allow a spectrum across hyperscalers, controlled environment, all the way to very, very disconnected environment. And if we talk about continuums, I believe, or we believe, there's also a continuum of sovereignty that needs to be addressed. We need to have capabilities to have something that's very, very much isolated and disconnected under full control. But we also need to build the bridges to everything, up to the ways where we share data very openly, very freely across the world, across different types of devices and setups and regulations and companies. Think about research, climate change, viruses. Nothing stops at the European borders. So in the time of sovereignty, we also need to have the capability to adjust the needle based to the very, very specific requirements. So that actually leads me also to my last and final slide, I believe, where I'm just summarizing this from our position. Requirements are going to be driven by the use cases across the various sectors. I mentioned the one on manufacturing, on healthcare. We have the very, very same situation in manufacturing. How do we build, for instance, tightly integrated supply chains? How do we manage decarbonization along the line, mobility, financial, public sector, telco, energy, retail? Everything has same requirements to work across different technologies in a very, very controlled regulatory sovereignty and commercial environment. We have the organizations that we've talking about providing a very, very strong foundation to build the network to make all these things connecting to each other in a secure, trusted way to provide the necessary infra services to make it happening. And ultimately, we see all of that working on a cloud two-edge continuum. It's not isolated systems anymore. They cannot be. And before somebody asks, if somebody asks me, well, can't you do all of that already today? Well, the answer is actually yes, but it will always is very much and too often bespoke and individual solutions. What we need to gain is the scalability, that it becomes automated, a standard way that we do not have to generate contracts and negotiations and adapt individual standards. What we have done many, many times, what we have done as Atos, what many other companies have done many, many times, what we need to achieve is to make that something that is very well connected and very well working across different companies, across different organizations in Europe and beyond. And that's where we believe that work like in the Horizon groups, work in the associations we mentioned and beyond is going to be completely critical. So with that, I open the floor for some questions. I see a little bit popping up. So Mark, I cannot hear you. Mark, you're muted. So I cannot hear Mark. I will have to revert to a chat I've just been seeing. I was talking about new infrastructure in hardware being built throughout Europe. Is this company driven, EU Commission driven, or Gaia X driven? So the answer to that is there are a number of what is called important projects of common European interest, where actually technically member states come together and say, we want to address certain technology areas like the multi-cloud edge continuum, it's called IPSISIS, where member states actually bring a number of companies together and support activities for the development, for the research, development, and first industrial deployment of such solutions. There's one on cloud infrastructure services, one on 5G, and that is one area which works next to the EU funding schemes around Digital Europe Horizon and so on and so forth. So it's actually that could warrant another 60-minute presentation. But what I was referring to in the Cloud Edge Continuum picture was a picture out of the value chain that has been generated in the important project of common European interests, so the IPSI Cloud Infrastructure Services.
I'll say first, thank you for an excellent presentation. I think we were almost out of time. You had a great conversation about the deployment of new edge hardware across Europe. And you've discussed a great number of issues, which I could discuss with you probably for a day or two, but we don't have that chance right now. As a final point, what would you think is the biggest as a corporation needs to work on?
Your voice was breaking up. There was what is the big thing?
What is the biggest objective for Etos in this new cloud edge continuum development?
So for us, there's two things. So we have a number of products which actually try to address edge. We are also a hardware company, cybersecurity, and decarbonization. That's the one thing as a very particular interest, but. And we also have offerings like OneCloud, which make all that happening, and platforms for data exchange. But the big thing for us is we need to look at the value. The value is if we create ecosystems for manufacturers, if we create ecosystems for health, and we see ourselves as somebody who can really, really support getting stuff forward. That's why we believe working in these associations with other companies. It's not a one-shop story. It's a cooperation that we need to build. And I think we can help you move forward.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Klaus. And thank you to everyone who is paying attention. And we'll be kicking over to the next. Thanks, everybody. We'll be starting the next session very shortly. I appreciate everyone's attention. We'll continue the next studio very shortly.